Hey, good afternoon, and welcome to this edition of At the Table. This is your host, Kelly Lincoln, and I am coming to you live and in person from Starbucks in New York City, out of the corner of Lexington and East 87th Street. And here wishing you all who observe such things, happy Easter, happy Ishtar. And for those of you who are confused as to why Passover isn't happening at the same time Easter is, well, Christians are on a solar calendar, Jews are on a lunar calendar, and in order to keep the lunar calendar lined up the way it's supposed to be with the equinoxes, there are every so many years a 13th month has to be inserted. So there are those that are saying, hey, it's wrong because God says this. Well, no. And they forget that there is a internet. They don't know that lunar calendars work differently from solar calendars because sun and Roman solar calendars and solar gods and all of that good stuff. So that's why you all are seeing Passover stuff a good month early. So get your lamb shanks, get ready to make that virgin lamb stew for Passover. This may have to go into two parts because, look, I just started and I've got all this time. Stock up on your kosher for Passover stuff now. Now, ladies and gentlemen, now. I'm doing some stuff here. What do I got here? A lot of conspiracy theorists are all up in arms about the Illuminati and the world order and all of this, but they seem to forget once again that even Christianity talks about a new world order when Jesus comes again. And we now have a fire truck sort of sitting out in front. Oh, look, they're stopping there right across the street from me. Company 22, ladder, whatever. I'm just slithering away today because I turned 61 this past Wednesday, and they're stopped because some idiot wants to park their car. I want to digress as I always do and talk a little bit about illumination and enlightenment and why there are those that fear being illuminated, being enlightened. Well, you see, conspiracy theorists, once they uncover the so-called plot, they are then illuminated themselves and are now part of the plot. But a lot of that illumination comes from overcoming the primitive portion of our brain, that fight, flight, food, fuck part of our brain, also called the reptilian brain. Just that instinctual, that gut feeling that, you can see it in action when you watch major conservative political rallies and hear it on political TV, that they're all about the, this guy, I gotta stop here because this guy just ain't gonna make it into the parking place. Just not going to make it. I'm going back to this. I am now illuminated that some people in New York don't know how to fucking parallel park. Dude, you're not making it into that space. Anyway, going back to this. No, and go back to being illuminated. Despite our advances in science and tech and even the way we perceive the universe and religion and everything, we remain mired in that primal survival mode. We still think, refer to cities as urban jungles. Now, what about the suburban veldt, where there's far more predation than on the veldt than in the jungles? And it's like, the question is why? Why are we so fearful of change? And I think it's because change invokes that primal fear. your surroundings are different. You don't know where you're going. You're on high alert, hyper aware of your surroundings. It's like dieting. You lose those first 5 pounds and then your body goes, hey, what's going on? And suddenly everything starts going what appears to be haywire. You suddenly find foods that you're trying to cut out of your diet beckoning to you. You're like, not just a little piece, but all of it right now. And the unknown is exactly that. It's something that we are not aware of yet. It's the unknown, what is not known, and therefore it's unalienated. We fear the light. We fear knowing. And as long as we remain in a dimly lit room, there's a modicum of safety because we can still see our surroundings. But if they're not so bright as to momentarily blind us. And then again, it's no surprise that Christians, the most of all, seem to fear light. They call it evil. Controlling others requires people to remain unilluminated in the dim. And to even go that far is that King James even decided that the Roman god of light, Lucifer, is now the devil. Yet Lucifer is equated with the Venus in the morning, but he's also the light of the moon at night. And there was no fall of man, there's no original sin, because how can we be born into sin if we are created in the image of our Creator? How can beings with no will nor autonomy of their own, the angels, rebel? Can God sin? Can God miss the mark? Go further on to this. How can it be that two bishops of the Catholic Church bore the name Lucifer? Saint Lucifer of Calgary and Lucifer of Siena. Also, according to Wikipedia, in Latin, the word is applied to John the Baptist and is used as a title of Jesus himself in several early Christian hymns. The morning hymn Lucis Largitor Splendide of Hilary contains the line, Tu veris mundi Lucifer, you are the light bringer of the world. Some interpreted the mention of the morning star Lucifer in Ambrose's hymn Aeterne Rerum Conditor as referring allegorically to Jesus, and the mention of the cock, the herald of the day, Praeco, in the same hymn referring to John the Baptist. Likewise, in the medieval hymn Christe qui lux es et Deus, some manuscripts have the line Luciferusem proferens. The Latin word Lucifer is also used of Jesus in the Easter proclamation prayer to God regarding the Paschal candle. Flammas eos Lucifer matutinus inviat ille in quam Lucifer qui nescit occasium Christus filius tuus qui regressus ab inferis humana genere serenis illuxic et vivet et regnat in saecula saeculorum. May this flame be found still burning by the morning star, the one morning star who never sets, Christ your Son, who coming back from death's domain has shed his peaceful light on humanity and lives and reigns forever and ever. In the works of Latin grammarians, Lucifer, like Daniel, was discussed as an example of a personal name. I'm just going to let that sink in for a bit. It wasn't until King James commissioned his translation of the Bible that Lucifer, that Jesus, also became equated with the devil. Think about it. Now, how did this change come about? What were the perceptions behind this change? More means of control? Suddenly, after the translation of King James, early hymns could no longer be used because they were equating Jesus with the devil. Can't have that. And actually, the biblical text where there's the prophecy of equating deity, morning sun, the morning star, Venus, with a king. Don't know much about the way people, bright shining but fades out in the full illumination of the sun. An overlay of something that was never there. Going back to change. I'm going to segue back. You're listening to At the Table here on Spreaker Radio and today on netroochradio.com. And I want to give a shout out to the good folks at Unity Networks, especially our, my lovely friend Apache, who, along with all the other awesome folks, keep our servers up and running on the San Carlos Apache Reservation in Arizona. Shout out to Sunscreen in London and our Pakistanians up in Flip, not that one, and Yuriku, and GM and Program Director Justice. All these folks do yeoman jobs and they're awesome. And I'm going to ask of you guys today while you're listening to us on network radio or even here on Spreaker, flip on over to patreon.com/netroochradio and become a subscriber. Or you can also slip at the table and you can subscribe to my awesome show, which after this week will be live once again because I'm going to be out of a job. Yay! The type of work I do is like that. It's cyclical. I will be going back to my part-time job in June. So change is hard. Change makes you feel like your body is dying. My body is dying. It's paycheck time. So going back to metaphors and everything with change and your body feels like it's dying. When you want to make a change, you have to leap into it. You're stepping into a void, into the unknown, and you have to trust that the universe is going to take care of you. This is known as prono, that the universe is out to help you. Everyone is out to help you, which is far more fun than paranoia. And when you're going about change, no matter what it is, something changes you can do all at once. Other takes small steps in order to trick your mind and your body into not going, I am dying, I am not going to shed this last 20 pounds. Change also means recognizing when your primitive responses are being manipulated for the advancement of bullshit. And change is tough. And change triggers your fight flight response. And you can see these fight-flight responses on display at Trump rallies. Trump says, these protesters, they bring it on themselves. Well, technically, yes, if they didn't want to get beaten up, then they wouldn't be protesting. They wouldn't be showing up to the rallies in order to have their mere manifestation on the same physical plane as Trump and his supporters. And that wouldn't happen. So there isn't a way of provocation, but the interesting thing is that every single fight, you can see the fight response invoked. Trump could choose to ignore the people protesting him, but instead he chooses to single them out and then sick his crowd on him. More fight or flight. there's a move to allow guns on the floor of the Republican convention in Cleveland, Ohio. Now that's going to be fun. Open carry on the floor. What could go wrong? Not even the NRA, which is open carry advocates, will permit guns at their meetings. They are gun-free zones. Everybody, every place else has to be a gun-filled zone. An armed society is not a polite society. It's a hair trigger society. All you need to do is take a look at what happened in the height of the 80s and 90s with inner city gangs. It might have been armed, but still got shot for stepping on somebody's shoe, knocking into them accidentally. Respect doesn't come from a barrel of a gun, but fear does. This segues into, again, the political and religious cults. Both seek complete and total control over their membership that is not the power brokers. One set of rules for you, another set of rules for me. All organizations exist like that, even business organizations. The higher up you go, the more liberties you can take within boundaries. But your boundaries, as you move up, expand. Dear friend Isaac Bonowitz created what he calls the A, B, C, D, E, F cult checklist. And in it, he has a specific list of ways of identifying if something, some organization, is a cult by how they treat their people, how they react to the outside world. And it's a brilliant piece of psychology, and I recommend everybody look it up. And because you're still dealing with I am the way and the light, as it were. When you step out of line, you are shamed. When you disagree, you are shamed. When you betray the party, the cult, the organization, several things can happen. You can get shunned by your own people for a certain length of time. You can get ostracized by everybody and their families, which happens in religious cults when you get kicked out. All you need to do is look at ostracization is the young men who got thrown out of the FDLS cult when they became old enough to, when they hit puberty, because they were in competition for the girls. Terror organizations prey upon that lack of sexual freedom to bring people in, young men in. You're in a country where you have multiple wives, the available single females is going to be very limited. You have no chance of reproducing, so why not go and blow yourself up? Gotta be better than the idea of having 72 women to screw and having, has to be better than what you're enduring now. And the methods that religious cults control their followers and political cults control their followers are extremely similar. Both have scripture, and now both use media. All you need to do is take a look at all the televangelists on television and see how that works. Listen to people like Pat Robertson telling somebody that he needs to, like, divorce his dying wife, or tell this one woman who can't afford X, Y, or Z, go, oh, well, you should take that the money you were going to spend on that and send it to me. Your political organization, cults, send you emails implying that you are delinquent and you owe, and you need to send money to the party in order to, like, not be delinquent. They have their media controls. And to make it even more fun, there is now Prolfi to make sure that you don't think. I was off on that last week with the with the shaped reality shows. You take a look at all these shaped reality shows and you're thinking, I really don't want to know these people. Even though you're aware that it's edited and, you know, shots are retaken and everybody knows what's going on, so there's no, you know. It's all about tightly controlling a narrow interpretation. If you're a King James originalist, then no other translation of the Bible is real. So, because it's King James. And there are people out there that say the only accurate translation of the Bible is the King James Version, which selectively translated specific words to meet the approval of the king's paranoia. The infamous "Thou shalt not suffer a witch to live," the word that they translated as "witch" is more closely translated to that of a poisoner. But that one line gave rise to the witch trials. So it's all about how narrowly defined something is. And you need to expand your definitions. Yes, there is dead air. I've got another 40 minutes I need to, well, not 40 minutes, maybe another 35 minutes to fill. And I know what I wanted to do. Let's go on to talk about the awful folks from the Mallor refuge who quite literally shit in their beds. When the folks from the BLM and the FBI went into it to survey the damage from the standoff, they discovered that not only had they overflowed the septic system, shit on the graves of the Burns Area Paiute Nation, but they also shit in the government offices. They have photos, there are photos where you can see fecal matter on the floors. They completely trashed the place, and these are the people who claim they can better conserve the land if it's privately held than the United States government. They also apparently broke into an explosives locker. I mean, so many felonies, so little time for them to serve it all out. But these are people who claim that laws don't apply to them, rules do not apply to them. And I see we have somebody else trying to move into a parking space that he's just not going to fit into. So maybe he's just going to wait for the woman in the Audi to move so he can park. in the typical New York fashion, which is just hose it in there. Have people that are threatening violence against the people who work for the Bureau of Land Management there, the law enforcement of Burns, of Harney County. People saying they, you know. So it's getting more interesting. But if you are an American and you claim to be sovereign, how can you do that? Titles of nobility are not permitted in the United States of America. Which goes further to state that you are not entitled to a jury of your peers because you are not nobility. We do not have titles of nobility. And when you read the Sixth Amendment to the Constitution, you will not find a trial to be heard, a trial by a jury of your peers. What it says is, Amendment 6 is the right to speedy trial by jury, witnesses, and counsel. So your Miranda rights are a combination of your Fifth and Sixth Amendment rights. And this is what it says. In all criminal prosecutions, the accused shall enjoy the right of a speedy and public trial by an impartial jury of the state and district wherein the crime shall have been committed, which district shall have been previously ascertained by law, and to be informed of the nature and cause of the accusation. The word peer does not exist in the amendment because a peer is a nobleman. And sovereigns go all the way back to Magna Carta, where they point to the jury trial. Well, actually, Magna Carta had two ways of trying people. If you were a peer, if you were nobility, you had the right to a trial by jury. If you were not titled, you were not a peer, you went straight up before the judge, which today we call a bench trial. Which is also why sometimes police officers will opt for a bench trial rather than a jury trial, because they have better odds of getting a lighter sentence or getting off with the judge having the case heard by a judge rather than by a jury. So, to all you sovereigns out there, you are not kings, you are not peers. You have, really, and if you're so enamored of Magna Carta, you don't have a right to a trial by jury. You should opt for a bench trial and let a single human being decide your fate. But then again, you enjoy wasting people's money. You enjoy, you know, not contributing to the roads you drive on, nor to the nation, country that defends you. Your right to be shitheads. The sheriff, by the way, sovereign citizens, was the tax collector. Think so. So, if you want to read more about the Sixth Amendment and the interpretations of common interpretation of the Sixth Amendment, constitutioncenter.org, which is an awesome place in Philadelphia. I love that place. I've been there several times, and just, if you're anywhere near Philly, you need to go there and watch. They have a sunlight show, lots of historical documents. It's just a really cool place to be. And you just need to just go. And I'm going to read the Sixth Amendment interpretation. The Sixth Amendment guarantees a cluster of rights designed to make criminal prosecutions more accurate, fair, and legitimate. But the institutions of American criminal justice have changed markedly over the past several centuries, forcing courts to consider how old rights apply to new institutions and procedures. At the time of the founding, there were local sheriffs, but no professionalized police forces. Instead, ordinary men took turns serving as constables or night watchmen. Criminal cases were almost always brought by victims, not by public prosecutors. At trial, neither side typically had a lawyer, so both victims and defendants represented themselves. Think small claims court. Trials were like shouting matches, Judge Judy, in which victims and defendants argued and brought other live witnesses to tell their stories. They lasted minutes or hours, not days. So when you're watching these arbitration shows, that you're looking more at life, more or less at what the early form of the American justice system looked like. Juries of 12 ordinary men were central players in this system. They were local citizens who often knew the victim, defendant, and other people and places involved. They also knew which charges subjected defendants to the death penalty, as many felonies did, and which did not. Jurors looked witnesses in the eye and debated both whether a defendant was factually guilty and whether he deserved mercy. They checked the government's power to punish and applied the conscience of the community to the public eye, assuring everyone that jury justice had been done swiftly, impartially, and fairly. That's not nullification, by the way. The framers of the Sixth Amendment sought to strengthen this vigorous adversarial process. Continental Europe had long used an inquisitorial system in which magistrates investigate crimes and judges take leading roles in framing the issues, digging up evidence, and questioning witnesses. The Anglo-American system that the Sixth Amendment codified, by contrast, leaves it to each side to conduct its own investigation, present its own evidence, and argue one side of the story or another. And it goes on to talk about how over the centuries, American law enforcement and criminal justice changed with the institution of professional police forces and lawyers and the like. And it also goes into talk about how defense lawyers also increasingly plea bargain. Ron, this was when? The Supreme Court ruled that virtually every aspect of the Sixth Amendment applied not just to federal, but to state prosecutions, which vastly expanded the amendment's reach because most criminal prosecutions occur in state court. This quote-unquote incorporation of the Sixth Amendment against the states also required the court over the past half century to spell out the amendment's protections and apply them to a variety of criminal justice systems across the nation. This is where sovereign citizens get the idea that we are a corporation because of the incorporating, the bringing in of having federal statute, the constitutional statutes, applying across the board equally from not just on the federal level, but the state local level as well. I'm not going to read the rest of this, but you should go check out constitutioncenter.org. They are just, again, really an awesome place to be. So there's a lot of game playing going on right now up at Mahler and with the Bundys over jurisdiction, constitutionality. You're not the boss of me and other assorted legal bullshit. And again, I'm broadcasting live from Starbucks at Lexington and East 87th here in New York City, so you've got music in the background, which I'm sorry, folks, can't help it. And you're listening to At the Table here on NetrootsRadio.com and Spreaker Radio. And for Netroots Radio, you can hear us 24/7 both at NetrootsRadio.com and on the TuneIn app. You should get that, download that TuneIn app. Our podcasts are available from Libsyn, direct download, or you can catch us on the iTunes or your favorite podcatcher. And we're just all sorts of fun people. We have a lot of good things going on. And yesterday, I was watching the Bernie Sanders rally, and the port, and for those of you who haven't seen the video yet, well, Senator Sanders was speaking at a rally in Portland, Oregon. A little sparrow landed on the stage and then flew, which is what made the crowd go crazy. And then it flew up and landed momentarily on the podium. And Sanders just let the moment go. And everybody was remarking on how the crowd went absolutely batshit crazy over it. Well, in Portland, in the IFC comedy Portlandia, there was a sketch called Put a Bird on It. And it took our heroes into a store in Portland, and they stuck a bird on everything. So there was that reference right there. And if you get a chance to see that sketch, it was on Rachel Maddow's show last night. And the but the look of absolute delight on Bernie Sanders' face was just wonderful to see. It was just amazing. And the difference between the two political parties in their campaign, while both sides are urging each of their lower delegate count candidates to like get out of the race, to drop out and just let one person have it all, while one side is actually driving a debate and forcing a conversation on things that are very, very important to us all as Americans and the world. The other side is engaged in really early 19th century politics. You know, where the personal insult was David, you went there. And so civility in campaigning is only actually a recent phenomenon, because first you had radio and television, so you had to be more careful about what was said. Then you have the internet, and now you even have to be more measured about what you say. You have to be more creative about what you say. So how you approach your platform and how you're going to deal with situations is all about whether or not you allow your middle brain to mediate between your forebrain, the rational brain, and the irrational brain, parts of your brain. And you balance those out. And you can see those sort of things going on with the way our president responded to the Brussels terror bombing and the Parisian bombings. And I want to take y'all back to when I was growing up and we had the IRA bombing civilian targets in London. The IRA, the Irish Republican Army, which was working to get the Protestant English out of Northern Ireland, besides beating the shit up and murdering Irish Catholics, also took to Irish Protestants, rather, took to bombing targets in England, including Harrods department store. 6 people were killed, 90 people injured. And this was done by the Provisional IRA. The IRA Army Council claimed that they didn't cause it. And in 1993, the Harrods was once again bombed by the IRA. In 1973, the Old Bailey was bombed. And these were car bombs. So, Islamic cultists, death cultists, were not Al-Qaeda, Daesh, were not the first to use car bombs in terror. And the idea of terror is not so much kill people. Yeah, you want to kill people, but you also want to have them shit their pants psychologically. And the fear-mongering that we see coming from the right, extreme right wing over this, that's terrorism because you're psychologically harming you. They're pushing your survival bones. You know, it's all about how you respond. You allow fear to rule your life, you're being terrorized. If you don't allow fear to rule your life, then you've defeated terror. And I'm going to say goodbye to you all. It's been a lovely day. I have to go back to work. Stay tuned for Katie Speaks. Coming up next on netrootsradio.com. And by the way, this will be rebroadcast again at 6 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time, 3 o'clock Pacific Daylight Time. So at the end of this, that's why I'm saying, and Katie Speaks follows my show at 7 p.m. Eastern. Take care. Happy Easter, happy Ishtar, happy spring. And remember, Hail Eris, all hail Discordia. Have a good one.